Thank you. as well as in your bulletin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God wills. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Give us the strength of mind and body so that we suffer because of human sin. We rise victorious through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated for our lessons this morning.
The first lesson today is from Isaiah chapter 58, verses 9 through 14. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong, and you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. If you refrain from trampling the Sabbath, from pursuing your own interests on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the holy day of the Lord honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways, serving your own interests, or pursuing your own affairs, then you shall take delight in the Lord, and I will make you ride upon the heights of the earth. I will feed you with the heritage of your ancestor Jacob, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. The next reading is Psalm chapter 103, verses 1 through 8, to be read responsibly. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits.
Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the dead, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy.
Who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles.
Lord, for your vindication and justice are all over us.
He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The second lesson today is from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 18 through 29. You have not come to something that can be touched, a blazing fire, and darkness, and gloom, and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet, and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that not another word be spoken to them, for they could not endure the order that was given. If even an animal touches the mountain, it shall be stoned to death. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, "I tremble with fear." But you have come to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse the one who is speaking, for if they did not escape and they refused the one who warned them on earth, how much less will we escape if we reject the one who warns from heaven? At that time his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised. Yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heaven. This phrase, "yet once more," indicates the removal of what is shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us give thanks, by which we offer to God an acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for indeed our God is a consuming fire. Here ends the lesson.
Thank you, Scott. Now, as you heard, this first lesson has to do with what is an acceptable worship from the Old Testament. What's an acceptable worship? Not just going through the motions, but also performing the right, living the right life the other 6 days of the week. Be just. And then carrying that out in a just worship as well. And then as we read from this the second lesson, in Hebrews we hear that our worship is not going to be like back in the Old Testament where it's smoke and fire and fear and awesomeness. There's going to be a joy and a thanksgiving because of this, because of who Jesus is and who God is in Jesus to us. It's going to be different now. We offer to God this acceptable worship with reverence and awe. God is a consuming fire, but Jesus Christ is the one among us. So we get to our gospel lesson. Would you please rise, and we'll once again hear about worship, singing gospel acclamation.
Jesus, you know, we're to be people of action, not just waiting.
and that applies to so much of our life together. What might we do? But what might we do in the name of Jesus? What might we do like Jesus? Let's pray, all of us. Good Lord, you are one who has us, act each in his own way. A congregation is full of different people acting with their gifts and talents and abilities. Help us to be ready always to be first in aiding our neighbor. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. As we gather together, I look at this lesson today that we're joining together in, and was immediately struck up. It's maybe a little bit more complicated how to get into this. And I'm reminded of those times in our house when myself or my wife, you know, were quietly doing, trying to get something done in another room. When we had kids around, there would be all of a sudden this loud noises or crashing noise, and then maybe screaming and then crying. And of course, as a parent, then you're like, you go in there, and of course, what's the first thing you say? All right, what's going, what happened here? All right, those of you parents know exactly what I'm talking about. Okay, what's going on in here? Or you're one of those kids, right? You're one of those kids, and when your parents came and said, all right, what's going on in here? And of course, truthfully, what do you say? Nothing. Nothing. And as a parent, you're like, nothing? I just heard this, you know, or the other things you say, nothing, or you go, So when we come and we encounter Jesus in this story today from Luke's gospel, this healing story, it's a little confusing, so we're going to go through it like what I call as a biblical expository sermon. It's like a mini Bible study with a sermon attached at the end of it. So if you want to go and take it out from your bulletin, we're just going to, and I'm going to walk you through it, do a little bit of explaining, so you can get what I think is the core of it. There's lots of things happening. It starts with Luke mentioning time. Time is really important in the first couple of verses. Okay? And the very first word is now. Something's happening now. Now, he was teaching in one of the synagogues, and then another reference to time, on the Sabbath. That's Saturday, Friday night to Saturday night. Now, things are happening in time, right now, on this particular day. And just then, like that, action. Just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. So you have now on the Sabbath, and then this reference to this woman shows up, but she's dealing with something that's not just now on the Sabbath. It's been this way for 18 years, 18 long years in her life. And though it may have just sort of been dumped on their laps right that very moment, she has dealt with it for a very long time. And if you have a chronic sort of a disease or something that you've dealt with, you know exactly what it's like to have something which follows you. It's not just, it's something that's chronic, you had it maybe since your child or something like that. That could be one of many things. You know, many of you know that I have epilepsy. I've had 4 seizures over 25 years. And so it's always kind of, you know, get up in the morning, take your meds, go to bed at night, take your meds. Okay? It doesn't necessarily, I don't live every day suffering from it, but it's there. It's there. Well, she's had this for 18 years, bent over. When, another time, when Jesus saw her, he called her over and he said, now, okay, so we're going to move to from time to something's happening. He meant, woman, you are set free from your ailment. When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. Boom! Something happened major. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, I want to stop right there. Jesus is acting. And this action provokes a reaction. Jesus has healed on the Sabbath. Wonderful thing for her. The leaders of the synagogue have a different view of it, and the key word there is the word indignant. It's not a word that we use, you know, in our own vocabulary, and I started kind of digging into what indignant is. Something like this. Indignant is when a person's, the reaction that a person has, a feeling, to seeing something which is unjust or unfair. Now that really changes the way that we might think about our synagogue leaders. Okay? We're used to being the synagogue leaders. They're just bad guys. They don't like Jesus. They don't get him. They're always immediately against anything he does. You know, if he does this, they do the opposite. I think that's a little bit simplistic here with them. This is what I think is happening, okay? Indignant. They look at what Jesus has done on the Sabbath, when you're supposed to be resting and you're not doing these sorts of things. And they think that it's unfair that Jesus is doing this on the Sabbath. Because listen, here's what they say. Here's what they say. There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day. I think what they're thinking is that, listen, Jesus, this is a day for rest. There are 6 days you could have come in and cured her. 6 days you could do all these wonderful things that you're doing, but it's not fair. It's not fair that she gets to do this on the Sabbath. And are you going to cure everybody else on the Sabbath? Right? Or another way of looking at it is, okay, you start working on the Sabbath. Well, do other people then get to, are they supposed to be doing stuff on the Sabbath too? They might even be thinking about themselves. Well, are we supposed to be? You know, this is a day of rest. Are we now a synagogue leader supposed to be doing other things on the Sabbath? So let's not be too hard on them. But from their perspective, Jesus may be really unfairly favoring this woman, and there's nobody else. Nothing else has happened on the Sabbath. From their perspective, they might think that Jesus is showboating. Okay, right? Nobody, none of this other stuff is happening. So he gets to do this, and everybody will see and know. So just let's cut them a little bit of slack here. Well, this is what he does. The Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites." Okay, now what's happening here? They think that he's being unfair, and he calls them hypocrites because he perceives in their actions that they are the ones who are being unfair. All right. Let's go to his reasoning now. Does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? Pretty simple action, right? Of caring for your animals. So he says, this is not this woman, the daughter of Abraham, who Satan bound for 18 long years, be freed from this bondage on the Sabbath day? You see, what he's saying is, you will take care of your regular chore labor with your animals on the Sabbath day, and yet, you know, would you not then take care of this woman on the Sabbath day if you were able to? It might not seem like a fair comparison, but what he's saying, you know, is the simple things that you do for your animals and for your, would you not do those also for this woman? When he said this, all his opponents, it says, were put to shame. It doesn't say necessarily that Jesus put them to shame, like, I'm trying to shame you. It may have been also that they just felt shame somehow because of the way that he was able to point out that they were not very consistent and would care for their own, but they would not care for her. But the important thing now, as we talk about worship, the entire crowd was rejoicing on the Sabbath now. On the Sabbath, the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. I'd like for us to think about this a little bit. These synagogue leaders are very focused on what Jesus has done. And in the middle of it, and this is, I think, why Luke shares the story, it's not so much, Jesus does lots of miracles. Jesus does lots of miracles, and they are in some ways right, pointing out, Jesus, you do a miracle for her. How about a few more? Okay? Why do you single out her on this day? I think I think they are bound up in looking at what he does. Look at what Jesus does. And they miss, of course, the point, which is Luke's point in his whole gospel. Oh, yes. Look at what Jesus does, because look at who Jesus is. These are not just miracles. They're not just helping another person. Okay? Even though he says, you know, you take care of your animals, you need to take care of the people around you. It's much more than that. This is God's Son. This is the Messiah. These signs are not the important thing. It's this person who's the important one. And so he points that out. And the people, the synagogue leaders struggle with this. But the people look at this and they see something in Jesus. Not just the things he does, but the person he is. And many of them believe that he is the one. We gather here today together, and like the synagogue leaders and the people, we can look at the total gospel of Luke and see all the things that Jesus has done, and we can say to ourselves, okay, now what should I do? And I have news for you. The result of saying and looking at what Jesus does and saying, well, then now what should I do? There's going to be many, many different answers. We are not always going to agree on exactly what Jesus is doing, and especially what exactly I should do in any given situation. There's going to be a number of different opinions. There's going to be different ways to work it out economically, or politically, or religiously, or in my particular circumstance and time and place, right here in Granite Falls, and in my neighborhood, and amongst my family members. But the thing which is always true, and that is that Jesus is the Messiah, he's the Son of God. And when we find that as the thing which unites us, when we pursue that as the one that unites us, we, I believe, will be able to not always agree with how things should be done, but understand what truly unites us. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus Christ is the one who's died for the sins of the world. Jesus Christ is the one who is offered here and bread and wine for you, body and blood, forgiveness of sin, new life which lasts forever. So we gather together today, united by that one belief that we share. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. We confess that in our creed. I believe that he is here with us, body and blood, through man, through God, true wine and true wafer, true body and true blood, for me, for my sins. Let's pray. Gracious Lord God, you brought us together here today. And it's easy to focus on the things and the acts that we do or that Jesus does. And to not always agree on what we should do given what we see and what we hear. But bring us first to find our common life and belief and passion and conviction that Jesus Christ is the one true Son of God. And in confessing that, recognizing that the Holy Spirit is putting that in our hearts. And if the Holy Spirit is putting that in our hearts and in the hearts of those around us, we are united as the body of Christ here in Holy Communion. Amen. Now let's continue with our song here. God is here. It is hymn number 526. Thank you. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he arose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in God's extraordinary grace. Let us come near to the Holy One in prayer. You crown your church with steadfast love. Mercy, guide us continually in our baptismal covenant to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Use our diverse gifts and service to the whole people of God.
Pastor Peterson at the death of his wife,
pastor to the local church in Sacred Heart. We pray for Pastor Paul and Anna in their trip in Ireland. They'll be out on the roads, bicycles, and we pray for their safety in the midst of that travel and also traffic. We pray for all those divided by a spirit which separates us from you and from one another, and we meet in politics or society or families or churches. Bring about us unity in you and through you.
Amen.
The Lord.
Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by resurrection opened to us the way also to everlasting life. And so we give thanks for this gift of the Sabbath with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, the hosts of heaven. We sing and we join joyfully in this unending hymn.
Thank you.
life-giving God, in this meal you have bandaged our wounds and fed us in your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love.
This we pray
in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's continue singing 796, How Firm a Foundation. Son, and that same Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and love your neighbor.